I have squirted. It happened at the beginning of my sexual encounters. How can this thing cause so much drama and be so politicized? What is this liquid? Some very curious research suggesting that the bulk of this fluid is coming from.
So what's the deal with squirting? Is it pee? Is it ejaculate? Is it a secret third thing? Scientists sort of have the answers, but debates around this aspect of human sexuality remain surprisingly hot. I recently got to chat about this with Wendy Zuckerman, the host of Science Versus. Here's that conversation now. And by the way, if it wasn't obvious, it features some frank discussions about sex. Wendy, welcome back to the show. It's so great to have you.
Oh, thank you so much for having me.
So the last time you were on Science Quickly, you were talking about your deep dive into the science of anal sex, the very neglected science of anal sex. Tell me about your latest sexual health research endeavor.
I know, Rachel. I wanted to tell the audience, we cover other issues, you know.
Science Versus is a great, extremely varied show.
And
you are back here today to talk about more sex stuff.
Exactly. While next season is going to cover ADHD, fluoride, methamphetamine, creatine, I am here to talk about the first episode of this season, which is on squirting.
Incredible.
Yeah.
So there may be listeners who are like, what's that?
Great question.
So, yeah, what is it?
Yes. So it is this rather mysterious phenomena where folks who have a vagina, sometimes when they're extremely aroused, about to orgasm, at the moment of orgasm, a large amount of fluid will gush out of them. And it's this big mystery around what is this fluid? Where is it coming from? Is it coming from the vagina, the urethra? Is it pee? Is it female ejaculate? What is it? And for many years on the internet, you see these sort of fights playing out, and they often have this kind of political-ish tone to it, where often sort of feminist websites will argue it is not pee, we are not peeing, we have a special ejaculate and this is what it is. And then you have these kind of other websites that are saying, you know, kind of downplaying the squirt and saying, no, it is just pee. It is just pee, get over it, it's just pee. And then in the middle of that, you have a lot of people being angry. And so we just wanted to say, like, this is ridiculous. We're in 2025. How can a physiological phenomena, how can this thing cause so much drama and be so politicized? What is this liquid? We should be able to know. We have very sophisticated science. We should be able to determine what this liquid is.
Absolutely. So what did you know about the concept going into making this episode?
So I have squirted. It happened just sort of at the beginning of my sexual encounters, to keep it vague enough. When it happened to me, I was really thought it was pee. I was quite certain. I wasn't devastated or anything. I was just like, oh, bodies are weird, but I don't want to be cleaning the sheets every time that this happens. So I'm going to kind of train my body not to do that. And I was able to. Nowadays, it sort of has this very powerful element. It's a part of porn that you have guys making women squirt, and it has exciting elements to it, and it's sort of a real accomplishment that you have squirted. But I guess still, to a lot of folks who do it, and we did this large survey, which we'll talk about, of our listeners about who has squirted and how many times and how they felt about it, and you still see this sort of real confusion around how people feel about it, which is often tied to this idea of what exactly is this liquid. And so I was just very curious myself where people were getting their evidence from here and what we could know about it.
Yeah. Well, I definitely want to get into the survey itself. But first, with your episode on anal sex, you really found collaborators who were also mystified at the lack of research and who helped you, you know, make this very scientific. Were you able to do the same thing for squirting?
Yes. So with squirting, we actually do have some data that has really probed this question of what is that fluid. There's still a lot missing in the data, and we don't have huge studies. There's not thousands of women signing up to have their squirt tested. Although perhaps they would, based on the fact that we had thousands of people responding to our survey. So we have sort of a bunch of small studies that have been well done. And so in this case, while our survey was really helpful to sort of capture how many folks this is happening to and how they feel about it, we were able to look at the peer-reviewed literature this time to really see what's going on here.
Well, what is going on?
Okay. So let me tell you about one of the studies that we found. It was done by a French gynecologist, and we spoke to him, Samuel Salama. It was very funny when I was chatting to him. I sort of asked him, why did you do a study on squirting? And as you'll hear, it's very well thought out. And he started, he's like, well, I was going to do a French accent, but I won't. I'll save the listeners that. One accent will be enough. And he started going, it's an interesting phenomena. At the time, we really didn't know what the fluid was. And I was like, come on, Sam. Why did you do the study on squirting? And he says, okay. When I was younger, and I'm like, thank you. He said he had a lover. She squirted. They were both so curious what was going on. They tried to find out. And they tried to ask friends and doctors, and no one gave them a credible explanation. And so years later, he's studying sexology. He has a clinic that he can use that can really get to the bottom of this. I think he was asked, everyone needs to do a research project as part of his studies. And he says, great, now's the opportunity. And so what he does is he gets seven what he called systematic squirters, which meant that these were folks who could squirt every single time they got aroused. Because for some people, it sort of happens every now and then. But if he's going to the trouble to do the experiment, he wants to make sure that these folks are going to squirt when they need to squirt. So he gets the women to come into the lab. And what's really cool is that he does an ultrasound of their pelvis and bladder at various points of this squirting adventure. So first, he gets them to go to the bathroom and then ultrasounds their pelvis and bladder. And so he can see that after they've gone to the bathroom, the bladder is empty. That's what should happen. And then he says, okay, go into this very sort of sterile looking room in the clinic and go forth. he walked out of the room. He kind of waited for them to say come back. But what he did, which was very insightful, is he said, before you squirt at the peak of arousal, get me to come back in. I'm going to ultrasound your bladder again. Imagine what it would be like for these folks to hold on to that aroused state while you get ultrasound of your bladder. And then bladder's done, and then the ultrasound's done. And then he says, okay.
Get back to it.
Back to it. Now you can squirt. And he walks out of the room again. Then they squirt. He comes back into the room, as you can hear him on the tape, and he's sort of describing this liquid is everywhere. Because in some cases, it can be quite a lot of fluid coming out. The world record for squirt is 1.35 liters, which don't make me translate that into gallons.
No, it's a lot, though.
It's a lot of liquid. It's a lot of liquid.
Yeah, Americans know that a big bottle of soda is 2 liters, so we have a frame of reference.
Yes, okay. I thought so. So then he does another ultrasound of the bladder after the squirt is done. And what is really curious is that he saw that at the peak of arousal, before they had squirted, so remember their bladders were empty because they'd mm-hmm. peed before this whole process begins. Then he ultrasounds their bladder at peak of arousal, and he can see the bladder has filled up again, which is very curious and very interesting for anyone who has had the experience going to the bathroom before a sexual activity, having sex, and then peeing straight after and wondering, that's so crazy, I just peed 15 minutes ago. But this is a very interesting phenomenon, and there must be something about, you know, heart rates going, blood's moving around, processes are moving faster. We're not exactly sure why this happens. But so bladder fills up. Then the squirt happens. Rachel, you want to guess what's going on with the bladder?
I would guess that it empties, probably.
It did. The bladder, yeah. The bladder was empty, telling us that the liquid was coming from the bladder. Yes.
Right.
And Sam also looked at the chemicals inside the squirt because he had all the liquid there, and he could see various chemicals that we tend to find in urine, so urea, uric acid, things like this. Other studies have found this as well when they've looked at the the chemicals in squirt. One study found that it was quite diluted.
Right. I was going to say it would make sense for it to be pretty dilute if the bladder is sort of quickly filling up again.
It would, although when I asked Sam about this, he said sometimes it's dilute and sometimes it's not. And he actually had a photo of the squirt and it looked like yellow pee. Maybe not the most concentrate pee one has ever produced, but it definitely did not look like water to me. And so from that study, it's only 7 women. But there's some very curious research that we also talk about in the episode that's also suggesting that the bulk of this fluid is coming from the bladder.
Right. So that mystery solved, but you also created this big survey that I think you said thousands of people responded to. So tell me a little bit about that.
Yeah. And I will say, although mystery solved, there is a tiny bit more mystery, which explains why you have this battle online. Because although the bulk of the fluid is coming from urine, in some cases, there is a little bit of this sort of other substance that ends up in squirt, which comes from the female prostate. And we discuss at length, there's a lot of sort of mystery, controversy around this gland, but both... If you have a penis, a vagina, you do have sort of this prostate gland, although it looks quite different. And so that is where the bulk of this fight comes from, is that sort of this idea that, okay, the bulk of squirt might be pee, but there's a little bit that comes from the female prostate, and that therefore makes it different. And so in our episode, we sort of discuss what on earth the female prostate is, some interesting new findings in that area, and whether that does sort of change the substance. At that point, that becomes a sort of philosophical argument. You know, is this an Arnold Palmer situation? Is it a Shirley Temple? Is it a Manhattan with a dirty olive juice? You know, we had many chats around the office about what is this? Is it changing it? Is it not? Is it... And I think that just depends on your perspective. But to go back to the survey, and I think that is where sort of that it all kind of comes to the fore, is that because we do see this pattern, and so our survey found this, but other research has as well, that for those who tend to think it's pee, they generally feel more negative about squirting, which makes perfect sense. If you feel like you have just peed all over your partner or peed all over your bed, that's not necessarily a great thing. Whereas if you feel like you have just ejaculated over your partner, well, you just had a sexy time. But from my perspective, I think if you are a squirter, you can feel good about what's happening, even if the bulk of what is coming out of you is coming from your bladder. In our survey, 45% of those with vaginas had squirted at least once in their lifetime. Other surveys show this as well. So that is a huge number of folks this is happening to. It tells us that this is a normal physiological process. I think you could feel good about it no matter what that substance is.
I think that's a great message. Were there any other surprising takeaways in the survey?
I was really surprised about how different people's reactions were. I've sort of classified it into you feel good, you feel bad, but actually reading through the various comments, there were so many varied perspectives about what had happened. For some of them, their partner had made them feel really embarrassed about it, which is awful. I could obviously see how that would happen. Whoa, what's going on? Did you just pee on me, babe? That sort of idea. But that is really harmful, particularly if you are starting out sexual relations, if you don't feel that good about your body. And Samwell, the gynecologist, just talked to me about this as well. He said he's talked to other folks who've squirted, and he said if very early on in their sort of sexual encounters as they're squirting, if they had a negative experience from their partner, that could really change how they felt about what was happening. If you don't feel like you're in a position to be like, no, bro, I just squirted, and get out of my bed. Don't make me feel bad about this very normal physiological function. I'm not going to make you feel bad about what comes out of your penis. So I think that's something really important. And for those listening, if you are with someone who squirts and it happens, even if you yourself are surprised, and after listening to this, you now know that the bulk of that did come from the bladder, really try to control how you might feel about it, because that can potentially have a big impact on someone. So that was really interesting to read. Then the array of different positive experiences from, oh yeah, it was cool, to felt powerful, felt amazing, best orgasm of my life, to just, oh yeah, it was just like another orgasm, but some fluid came out. So this very singular thing, squirting, can actually feel so different to so many different people. And the other really interesting finding that I would love, I know science funding is in a tough spot right now, but perhaps in future days. So squirting is always talked about, a phenomena that just happens if you have a vagina. And there's sort of been this assumption that if you have a penis, you do not squirt, you cannot squirt, because you ejaculate instead. That's the fluid coming out of you during sexy times. But in our survey, we just thought we'd ask people with penises, have you squirted too? We found that it was something like 7.6% of folks with penises said they squirted too. And we explicitly said, you know, we're not talking about ejaculate, cum, this kind of thing. We asked around to urologists about what they thought of this, and some were quite skeptical it would be that high. Some thought maybe, because, you know, we know that there's some mechanisms around the penis that if you are erect, you really shouldn't be able to pee, because it sort of blocks off that process, which is, thank you, evolution. You don't want someone peeing inside you. But there's a lot of variation in the human spirit out there, and so sometimes that mechanism doesn't work that well. And so it makes sense that, you know, one researcher we spoke to said it's possible that after a penis ejaculates, maybe if they then continue to be aroused, maybe then what comes out next is a bit more like pee. We really don't know. There was one case study in the literature that we found of someone with a penis who did squirt. So this was sort of like a verified singular case study of a man squirting. And then we have our survey, but that's all we know.
Wow. Well, I was going to ask what the avenues for the research are, but you already answered that. There's a whole world out there of people squirting to explore.
There's a whole world. Yeah, whether men do it as well. I think the thing that I'm most fascinated by at this point is why it happens. What is that process? When you talk to folks who have squirted, although I was pretty sure it was pee, a lot of people will say it doesn't feel like when you're peeing, it feels different. We asked researchers about this as well, and some of that is surely context. One example that a researcher gave us is if you think about pelvic floor contractions, because I asked, what's another example where context can make something feel so different in your body? And Dr. Nan Wise, who's a neuroscientist and sex therapist, said, if you think about pelvic floor contractions, we could do Kegel exercises right now while we're listening to this, and it would not feel particularly sexual in any way, shape, or form. However, when you go through an orgasm, for some folks, they will contract their pelvis, and it feels great. So that's an example of where, even though the muscles are basically doing the same thing, the context is so different, and so it feels different. It could be that perhaps the pathway to go from squirting to, you know, you're aroused, this fluid comes out, that however that's getting triggered in your body, that could be different to how pee happens when you go to the toilet and you pee. And there could be different things happening, different muscles getting pushed, different nerves getting sort of triggered off, and we don't know.
Yeah, well, a lot still to learn. Thank you so much for coming on to talk about this with us. I'm really excited to listen to the whole episode on Science Versus.
Thank you so much. Thanks for having me.